नमस्कार, माय नेम इज डॉक्टर दीप्ति बिष्ट, प्रोफेसर डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ चिकित्सा, फैकल्टी ऑफ आयुर्वेद साइंसेज, ज्योति विद्यापीठ, वुमेन्स यूनिवर्सिटी, जयपुर। इन नेक्स्ट इमरजेंसी केस आई एम गोइंग टू टेक सेशन ऑन एक्यूट मायोकार्डियल मैनेजमेंट विद फॉर दिस क्लास ऑफ EMS फोर्थ ईयर। वी आर गोइंग टू टेक दिस लेक्चर टूडे। लेट्स स्टार्ट द टॉपिक। Acute myocardial infarction. Before starting, let's have some important points to remember. Myocardial infarction is one of the gravest and most important medical emergencies, and it often has a sudden onset, striking like a bolt from the blue, and this coupled with an uncertain prognosis that the disease carries for the first few days, imparts it an aura of respectively an anxiety in the mind of the patient and his relatives as well as the physician concerned. And this disease carries mortality as high as 25 to 40%, and approximately half of the acute myocardial infarction fatalities occur within 1 hour of the event. So myocardial infarction results from thrombotic occlusion of the infarct related vessels, and it is most often a manifestation of underlying coronary atherosclerosis and result of coronary thrombosis. Known triggering factors include unusual physical exertion and emotional stress, both which may be associated with destruction of atheromas plaque. The result can be an acute coronary syndrome with clinical spectrum ranging from unstable angina through non-Q-wave MI to Q-wave MI. Other precipitating factors can be intercurrent illness, ischemic stroke, episode of hypotension, anesthesia, surgery, etc. Usually, myocardial ischemia and necrosis occurs from subendocardial to subepicardial region, and this entire process takes approximately 6 hours to complete, and this time period is called window period, because if treatment is given within this window period, then chances of survival of patient usually increases. But after the completion of window period, we have very little chances for patient survival. So before going to clinical features, some prodromal features which are usually seen before appearance of full clinical features are: if there is an attack of myocardial infarction, it develops suddenly, some form of prodromal symptoms arising from transient episodes of cardiac ischemia. These may consist of sudden appearance of chest discomfort resembling angina pectoris, accelerating angina or rest angina. Other prodromal features may take the form of an episode of syncope, sudden fatigue, or cardiac arrhythmia. Unfortunately, because of their diversity, such prodromal symptoms are often overlooked and sometimes with tragic consequences. Clinical features which are usually seen: acute chest pain, which is usually severe and prolonged. Typically, this is of constricting nature, located in the retroesternal region, and may radiate to one or both shoulders or arms to the neck, in the interscapular region or the epigastrium. Extensive myocardial infarction may be associated with only mild chest pain or on occasions be entirely painless. This is especially true in elderly patients, in long-standing diabetics, or in presence of heart failure. Other symptoms include anxiety, restlessness, tachycardia, profuse perspiration, and rarely unconsciousness. Signs which are usually seen are fast and feeble pulse, raised blood pressure, may be followed by fall if cardiogenic shock is associated. Heart sounds may be muffled, normal, or basal cracks in case of left ventricular failure is seen. Pericardial rub is observed on second or third day. So in a small group of patients, there may be bradycardia due to vagotonia, and there may be pallor or even syncope. Syncope is usually with inferior myocardial infarction. Muffled sounds in the form of systolic murmurs may be heard, which are usually results from left ventricular dilatation. Pulse may be slow or rapid or irregular. There may be persistent sinus tachycardia. Blood pressure may remain unaltered or even raised, though more often it drops by a variable degree. Now, investigation. Acute chest pain can occur in large number of conditions besides ischemic heart disease. These include pulmonary embolism, pleurisy, spontaneous pneumothorax, pericarditis, respecting aneurysm of aorta, biliary colic, perforated peptic ulcers, etc., cervical spondylosis, and neuromusculoskeletal disorders or diseases, also sometimes meningitis. Investigations which are usually done are ECG, serum enzymes, echocardiography, angiography. So, first of all, echocardiography is most important tool in diagnosis of acute attack. Abnormalities usually appear in ECG soon after the onset of MI and are generally well developed within few hours. So development of fresh Q wave or disappearance of R wave generally reflects Q wave infarction, while non-Q wave infarction is usually indicated by persistent changes in ST segment or T wave. Similarly, serum enzymes like CPK-MB and LDH are studied. CPK begins to increase within 6 to 8 hours of onset of MI. It peaks at 18 to 24 hours and falls to normal in 3 to 4 days following infarction. Similarly, LDH serum levels rise within 24 to 48 hours of onset, and it peaks at 3 to 4 days and fall back to normal in 7 to 10 days after acute AMI. Now, management. Management can be done in 2 steps. First one is pre-hospital management. Second is hospital management. So, in case of pre-hospital management, what we have to do? First, aspirin therapy. Oral soluble aspirin in the dose of 165 to 325 mg within 6 hours of onset of symptoms should be given immediately. It has and rapid antithrombotic effect. Then nitrates like isosorbide dinitrate in the dose of 5 mg sublingually should be given, and it may be repeated once or twice as required in 5 minutes. And after giving this, systolic pressure should be adequate. Then hospital management. Treatment in hospital is done usually with first immediate ECG, then blood sampling for serum enzyme studies, and third one is quick history and physical examination. Drugs which are usually given are antiplatelet agents like aspirin and clopidogrel. Analgesics which are given to relieve the severe pain are morphine sulfate in the dose of 10 to 15 mg intramuscular, or norphine 0.2 to 0.3 mg intramuscular or intravenous. Oxygen therapy is maintained at the rate of 3 to 4 liters per minute. And intravenous nitroglycerin is indicated for persistent pain relief. Oxygen should be administered in all cases for first 24 to 48 hours by nasal prongs. Patients with heart failure and other MI complications may need longer and more aggressive oxygen respiratory therapy. Antiarrhythmic drugs which are usually given are lidocaine, amiodarone, and beta blocker. So in such cases, this lidocaine is administered initially as 50 to 100 mg bolus, followed by infusion at the rate of 1 to 4 mg per minute. And anticoagulation therapy is next step, which is given in two schedules. First one is IV heparin, which is a standard or unfractioned heparin, 400 units per kg over 24 hours, IV for 3 to 5 days. Second is subcutaneously it is given, which is low molecular weight heparin. It is used in recommended dosage for 5 to 7 days. This heparin have better bioavailability, quicker onset. Other pharmacological measures which are usually employed are beta blockers, nitrates, ACE inhibitors, calcium channel blockers, and lipid lowering agents. These agents are usually given once the emergency situation is controlled, and after watching the full profile of patient, these drugs are advocated accordingly. General measures which are usually done: complete bed rest to patient, use of antiarrhythmics, tranquilizers and sedatives to reduce anxiety, diet should be nutritional and very light, care of bowel and bladder should be appropriate. So this was the management of acute myocardial infarction. In next topic, we will take some another emergency condition. Namaskar. Have a nice day.